First of all, I'd like to thank Professor D.B. Phatak and Professor Nagesh for being our mentor. And I would also like to thank our mentor, Himanshu Singh, who has been there for us in our internship period. This is the table of contents, everything which we'll be presenting today in our presentation. So, first of all, I'll start with what is today's methodology of study. So, initially, the students right now are studying in a problem-based learning manner. Now, what happens is in this manner is the student try to explore new ideas, but on a fixed predefined work paths, which have been assigned to them by their teachers. In this method, the student gain knowledge, but the knowledge gained by the students is quite temporary because they haven't used it in real fields. So after a particular period of time, the students forget the knowledge because of lack of using it. What is PBL? PBL, first of all, stands for project-based learning. This is a dynamic classroom approach. It is a new way for students to gain knowledge. In this method, the students learn by active learning as well as by inquiry-based learning. The students are divided and they are given projects by the teacher itself, and the students work in groups. One example which illustrates the difference between project-based learning and problem-based learning is, if suppose the teacher gives a student a task to develop wind energy, and in wind energy, the teacher has already tell us that using wind energy, they need to light a bulb. The student has the final target, they have the initial target, and they just need to complete the two dots. But if suppose they use project-based learning, then the project-based learning approach will be, the teacher just tells the student that you need to light a bulb. The student can find their own part to it. So they have their own creative way of thinking, and they can do it by in groups as well. Now I'll ask my friend Miraj to continue.
Thanks, Amma. So I'll be taking the implementation steps for this project-based learning. The first point is the identifying the challenge. The PBS lies on the challenge which is meaningful, doable, and implementable and feasible for the students to do. The next step is the crafting the driving question. It totally depends upon the teacher how he is driving the question. It totally depends upon the teacher what is the deep understanding that he or she wanted to give to the students through the project. The building the assessment allows the students to build up the solution for the particular modules that will be submitting to the teacher as a project. The plan backwards techniques allow the students to come out with the best feasible solution out of many solutions which is possible to for the solution for the module. The enroll and engage and facilitate the teams, these both the points are approximately similar, that talks about the collaboration and teamwork of the students. The project based learning is an external learning process that allows the students to keep the end product in mind which they know what is the core of the curriculum actually. So moving upon the next slide, what we have done in these next 2 months was we are trying to create that web service system which allows the teacher to create the projects and its associated modules. So a project has been divided, categorized into the sub modules, and the teacher can assign these sub modules to the students, and the students are allowed to submit these particular modules to the teacher. And these modules will be evaluated by the service system, and it is being displayed on the teacher's dashboard what is the status of each and every student and how he has performed in that particular project. Both the students and the teacher can see the status of the modules in the project through the directed dependency graph. Now what is the directed dependency graph actually? It tells about the dependency between the various modules in the project. It may happen that the students or a group of students working in the one particular module waiting for another module to come up with an output. It may happen that that particular module will be depending upon another module. So that particular dependency graph will show you the actual status of that particular project. The last point is module evaluation and peer evaluation, these things to be added in our project currently. But right now our project is in that phase that it will showing the dependency graph for that. So these are the technologies which we used in the project, the Django framework 2.0.5, Django REST framework which includes the Django REST API mainly, JavaScript, AJAX calls for calling the REST API, jQuery and wiz.js for dependency graph. So talking about the model specification, this is the high level for the any software engineer to talk about the basic ER model. So if we talk about that R model, we are having the four entities mainly, the teacher, project, module, and the student. So in teacher model, we are having the teacher ID as a primary key and the basic attributes like teacher details, username, password, and we are having the name field also. This is the basic entity. And this teacher can monitor the n number of projects that we are having 1:n relationship with the project. The project can have many modules that we are having with the foreign key as a teacher ID in the project. and we are having the module, in modules we are having the student ID, a project ID which as a foreign key. So this dependency will be taken in the module through this self relationship. The student ID we are having as a primary key, will be having the next details, and this will be dealt by in the model specification by the Rajat.
So now we will run through the model specifications of our project. We have basically four models. As Miraj told you, the first is the student model, teacher model, project model, and the module model, and it has several attributes, as Miraj has already told you. Then the basic goal that we had to complete was build a RESTful API system for the project-based learning component. So basically, we have several APIs for, like, we wanted a standalone server, so that it can, our particular system can be integrated with Moodle or Sunbird or any other platform that wants to use it. So we basically have made both the server side and the client side. The server side is fully ready. The client side we are using in order to see what all functionalities can be added, like can be shown by using the server side. So first of all, it contains the accounts model API, which basically has the like functionality for sign up and the login thing. When a user signs in, he is assigned a particular token. Like when you create a user, he is assigned a token using which he can access any of his characteristics that he wants. Suppose a user like logs in as a teacher, then he or she will be assigned a token using which he can add a project or add associated modules or add students to particular module in it. So basically, the authentication token plays an important role in this. Next, we have a project or module model API in which we can, like the teacher wants to add a particular project. So the project, there is a teacher project, like the get request gets a list of projects that belongs to a particular teacher. And post request, it creates a project on the basis of the particular teacher. Then we have a project info, which returns the information related to the particular project. And we have a get graph function, the get graph REST API, which basically, if we make a get request to the server, we get the nodes and edges related to the graph, using which we can plot the graph on the front end. Next, we have a student model API using which we can return all students' information, because suppose in this particular system, we wanted each one in the whole world to he can become a teacher or he can become a student as well. So like if a teacher wants to assign a particular student a particular module, then he should have access to the list of students who are currently registered to the particular system. So the student list API basically gives the returns all the students information as JSON to the client side. Next, we have a teacher API as well, using which we can get the list of all teachers who have been registered to the particular system. Next, we have a wireframe diagram which will be told to you by Anshuman.
So thanks, Rajat. This is the workflow diagram. First of all, we have home page. From there, we can go through the sign up page. And in the sign up, teacher as well as a student can sign up. Okay, after sign up, it will redirect direct to the dashboard, whether it will be teacher or student. In the teacher dashboard, there will be many things. And first thing is, you can see the detail of the project that he's already created. Okay. And then he can see the module dependency. Module means the sub problems of the project that he has created, that they created by that teacher. And after that, the most important thing, he can create a new project in which he can create modules, and he can assign the students to this particular modules. Those student is part of this project based learning system. And let's talk about student dashboard. And in the student dashboard, there is mainly two things. First thing is that he can submit the problem that is assigned by the teacher. First, actually, the student is a part of many projects. First, he will select the project in the project history page. After that, he can submit. And the next thing, he can see the graph in which it will show the module dependency.
Yeah, so next, let's come to the client side. What we have basically done in the client side, this is the basic homepage that we have created. If you click on the sign up button here, you have two options, sign up and login. You click on the sign up button, you get redirected to the register page in which you give the user details. And when you click on the create new account button, an AJAX call is fired using which the particular user gets registered to the project-based learning system. And this system is completely separate from the server. So basically, everything works through APIs. Nothing is in the same system itself. After we register a particular user as a teacher, we get redirected to the teacher's dashboard, in which you can see there are four tabs at the top: home, graph, student details, and the create new project tab. The home tab is basically to get redirected to the teacher's dashboard if you are on some other page. If you click on the create new project tab, you get redirected to the create new project page, in which you add the title of the project and the description of the project, and you get redirected to the modules list page. Basically, what we took here as an example is, when you conduct an experiment in a class, you have several steps that you need to follow step by step in order to reach at the conclusion. Like, conclusion is the final endpoint in a particular project. So we give the project name as chemical equilibrium, and we have a particular description for that particular project. Next, we need to assign modules to the for that particular project. So we assign the modules here, and we ask the students, and we tell the students about the description of what the teacher expects through that particular module. Next, what dependency means is, you can see that one depends two. That means the apparatus specification depends on the chemical specification. Obviously, the chemicals that you use, that affects the apparatus that you are using, right? So basically, the one depends on two, and three depends on both one and two. That is, the procedure depends on both the chemicals and the apparatus that you are taking. And similarly, the project, the observation depends on the procedure, and the conclusion depends on, basically, there are two procedures here who are working asynchronously. Like, they can work simultaneously as well, because one is for weak acid strong base, and one is for weak base strong acid. So both can take place simultaneously, and finally there is a common conclusion. So the common conclusion depends on both 4 and 6, that are the observations of the two experiments that we conduct through this project. And the last tab here, we have a student's list from which he can access the usernames, and he can search what all the student is expert at, and he can assign the students to the particular modules by entering the usernames there. Next, once you click on the submit button, the project gets added to the database, and this happens through AJAX call as well. Once the project has been assigned, you get redirected to the graph page, in which you get the dependency graph of the modules that you have created. Like, you can see here, first of all, you can see that the root of the graph basically is chemical specifications. Like, everything depends on basically the chemical specification, because on the basis of chemical specification, you get the apparatus specifications, and then all the procedures, the observations, and the conclusion, everything depends on it. So basically, you can get an overview of the whole graph from this. And you can see right now that all the color of all the nodes is currently the same. That means, initially, no module has been, nothing has been submitted by the students. So the teacher is still expecting a student to submit his or her report onto the project. The next part of us will be that. This is basically the teacher's project info. These are the projects that we had added to the, the teacher had added. So he gets a list of all the projects, and he can simply type, this was a search list. So he can simply filter out a particular project and get the graph related to the project there. Next, he can view a list of students from the student info tab that we had, student list tab that we had in the teacher's dashboard. Next, this was the teacher's side. Now let us come to the student side. Student side was basically, you saw here that there was there was a second module that was assigned to the user TanTrojan 123, and the fourth module was assigned also to the student TanTrojan 123 and the conclusion as well. All the three has been assigned to TanTrojan 123. So we log in the user as TanTrojan 123 as a student, and we click on the sign in button. We get redirected to the student search board. Here we click on project history, and we get redirected to the module info, where all the three modules that has been assigned to them and assigned to him, and the corresponding project has been mentioned, using which he needs to submit the report of whichever module he has completed right now. So first he needs to complete, he saw the graph, he saw that first the chemical specifications need to be done. So he can simply enter chemical specifications here, and he clicks on the submit button. Then he gets redirected to the page, and here he lists down whatever things he needs to do, and then he needs to click on the submit button, and the module gets successfully added, and the control shifts to the student's dashboard. Then if you see the graph, you see that the chemical specification is in a different color, which means the teacher can identify that this particular project's like this particular module's data has been submitted by the user, and after the evaluation thing, the color would become something different. Like after the teacher evaluates what actually the student has done, is it correct or correct or wrong? After he does that, the color of the node will change to a different color. Next, this was basically the client side that we had worked upon, and like everything works through API, so it is very easy to integrate it with any platform that you want. So now, in order to tell you the benefits of project-based learning, I would like to call upon Anshuman.
So if we talk about the benefits of the project-based learning, so let's talk about the first problem-based learning. What happens in our classroom, if teacher asks the question, only two or three students answers the question, and the rest are like feeling sleepy, and nobody care about that. So in the project-based learning, actually each and every student is active, each and every student is working something. Like us, we are working on a project, and he is actually knowing about that what is happening, why it happened, and what should be. In the project-based learning, student can implement in the real world application also. In this way, there is many benefits in the project-based learning.
Scope for improvement in our project. Right now, we don't have any evaluation procedure. So once the code gets submitted, we have no way of checking whether the code submitted is correct or wrong by the student. So two ways the code can be checked. First is code evaluation, which is done by the teacher itself, but it's a long process, because if a teacher has suppose 1,000 students or more under him, he can't just sit and check every student's code. So the second method which can be done is peer evaluation, in which we assign its peers itself will check the code for the student. Second thing, one disadvantage of PBL is that PBL isn't suited for subjects such as social studies, history, geography, in which the students have to learn something, they need to literally mug up. Practical knowledge will help them only up to a certain level, but PBL isn't suited for that. Third basic thing which can be improved in our project is we don't have a discussion forum. Right now the teacher himself has to decide what the student needs to do. The project itself is decided by the teacher. But in the discussion forum, what we can do is that the students itself can come up with the project, and then after getting the validation of the teacher, whether the project can be applied or not, it can be decided by the teacher. Future of PBL. Right now, in all over the world, PBL methodology of teaching is being implemented only in two places. First, it is implemented in CIC in Delhi, and second, it is used in West Virginia Institute. PBL method of technology will be more suited for us after the technological boom. Hence, PBL method will help us in the near future. And with PBL, students will learn in a much faster rate, and the knowledge which they gain with PBL will be with them for a longer period of time, and it will also help them to adapt to the real world. Conclusion. During our stay in internship for the last 2 months, we have tried to build up this system. The system which we have built up illustrates how PBL should be used effectively. We haven't come up with the way to check the code, but apart from that, I think we have illustrated how PBL should be worked in teacher and student model perfectly. That's what I feel. These are some references from which we got help in learning what PBL and problem-based learning is. Thank you. You're open for questions.
Basically, did you research on what PBL is? So this is not PBL, first of all, okay. System is good. I have no problem with the system. What you have developed is good. So purpose was to teach you about the cycles of software development and let you understand how the team work. So this is not PBL, okay. PBL is something bigger than this, what you have created. If we come to the requirement of a project-based learning system, okay. So nowadays projects are being managed. Okay, so like you mentioned that it is not possible to teach history, mathematics with this system. Yeah, you are right. But the projects are, even if they are in mathematics area or geographic area, they are still being used. Yeah. So companies are managing project using the project management systems, which are already there. Okay. So a separate PBL system is not required because there are project-based project management systems which are being used by the companies nowadays, and those can be used directly. See what happens in a project, like you said, the projects are divided into modules, correct? Companies do that. Company manager, project manager creates a project, then he divides the project into multiple modules, then he assigns employees to the projects. The system is already there, correct? And the communication, so once employee submits the report, others can comment on it, project manager can comment on it, and this is how they can create one more item, one more module for that project. So the systems are already there. The only thing, if we are going to use it in collaborative communities, we have to see if there is a open source project management system available or not, and if it is there, how we can implement it.
So there are tools available, but you may need to customize. For example, if you want to do peer evaluation, or if you are looking at 50 million students taking up such projects, so then you need to do some customization. But when you look at even the project management tools which are already available, there are so many things in them that, you know, people actually get lost. So why not have something which is very basic and which can be used for a particular course? For example, software engineering. I want to teach software engineering, or somebody wants to teach software engineering. So he wants to kind of a project which can actually run. But generally, I mean, if you see software engineering, how it is taught, people just read the theory and they do it, but then they don't understand, right? We have so many things today. We have GitHub, we have these, that, but we are not utilizing anything of this sort. So that is why we felt there could be a small thing, you know, where suppose I need a GitHub there, you know, I can tie GitHub to a particular module, right? Suppose I need to show them what is a code, quality checks, which can be done by code factors or so many things which are already available. So each of these modules could be tied to a particular thing. So where automation is not possible, let us say we can do peer evaluation.
Sir,
or something.
I want to answer that question, sir. One thing is that inside a company, they will take approximately 1.5 months just for the feasibility check, whether this particular project is feasible or not. Right now we are just planning for that, for the software, for any software development, we should check the feasibility, right?
Any employees
need to check the feasibility for 1.5 months. But in the 2 months, we are just on the development of the graph stage. So directly, we can't jump to the fourth level for this PBL. So PBL, we know that PBL is very expanded level for that version. Just now, we are developing from the scratch, so we are jumping up from level to level.
And
like the first time anything is built at a lower level. After that, more functionalities can be added upon it. But
no, so I am not saying that your work is not sufficient.
Yeah.
Your work is sufficient. What I am saying is that, see, PBL has a big disadvantage because it's project-based learning, correct? So once a student is doing a project, he can either be successful or become a good person in his area, or he might lost completely and he will say, he will decide that I am not a person for this particular field. This is the problem with the PVL. So if there is no guidance by the teacher, then a PVL will lead to failure of the students rather than teaching them more useful things.
Sir, actually the thing is that in a classroom, suppose a teacher teaches a particular topic, like whatever a student generally does is that he goes to home and simply mucks up whatever the teacher teaches to him or her in the class, but he is not actually implementing what he is learning in the class itself. Like there is no such methodology using which he is implementing what he is actually learning. So this is a way in which he can implement his skills and know where he stands actually.
Okay, done. Thank you.